And I call the First Minister.
Presiding Officer, thank you very much. It gives me great pleasure today to move this motion in my name, seeking Parliament's agreement to recommend to Her Majesty the Queen the appointment of a new Lord Advocate and a new Solicitor General for Scotland. These posts have a long history, a very long history indeed. The position of Lord Advocate was established long before the 1707 Union of Parliaments, and today they remain crucial to the rule of law in Scotland. The current combined prosecution and government advisory functions of the law officers have endured since the establishment of this Parliament under all administrations. However, as members will be aware, the government made a commitment at the recent election to consult on whether these dual functions should be separated in future. I believe there is a strong prima facie case to be made for that. However, it is important that Parliament considers the precise detail of any reform carefully. Change, depending on the nature of it, may require primary legislation, including possible amendment to the Scotland Act. So there are complex issues involved, but I can confirm today that the government will take forward a consultation in due course. Whatever the outcome of such consultation, though, it will remain hugely important that Scotland has law officers of the very highest calibre. I have no doubt whatsoever that the individuals I am nominating today fulfil that requirement. Before I turn to these nominations, I want to take this opportunity on behalf of Parliament to pay tribute to and thank the departing Lord Advocate and Solicitor General. James Wolfe has served as Lord Advocate in extraordinary times. The issues thrown up by Brexit and then the emergency legislation necessitated by the COVID pandemic have been complex and largely unprecedented. During this time, the government has benefited enormously from his intellect and from the clarity, expertise, and at all times, the scrupulous independence of his advice. James Wolfe has also represented the government at several important hearings, including the Supreme Court cases on Article 50 of the EU Withdrawal Bill, the EU Continuity Bill, and the prorogation of the UK Parliament. These are amongst the most significant constitutional cases of recent times and will surely take their place in the history books. I also want to pay tribute to the way in which James represented the Scottish Government when defending in the Supreme Court this Parliament's legislation on minimum unit pricing for alcohol. In addition, he's worked to reduce the amount of time it takes for the Crown Office to investigate deaths and also continued its work to improve the handling of cases relating to domestic abuse and violence against women. Any of these challenges and achievements in isolation would have been significant, but taken together, they represent a remarkable achievement and legacy. For Alison DiRollo, her time as Solicitor General marks the end of 35 years as a first-class public prosecutor, including a spell as head of the National Sexual Crimes Unit. For the last 5 years, Alison has served with distinction as Solicitor General. During this time, her role in establishing the expert group on preventing sexual offending will, I am sure, contribute to further improvements in the prevention and in the handling of such cases. Alison also represented the Crown Office in the Supreme Court on the highly significant Sutherland case, which concerned evidence used to convict paedophiles. For all of this and so much more, Alison DiRollo and James Wolfe have my thanks. Both of them have been outstanding public servants, and I'm sure they leave office with the very best wishes of everyone across this chamber. I now turn to my nominations for their replacements. My formal recommendation for Scotland's new Lord Advocate is Dorothy Bain, QC. Dorothy is, without doubt, and I think I can say this without fear of contradiction, one of Scotland's most senior and highly respected lawyers. She has extensive experience in both civil and criminal law and has appeared in cases at all levels, including in the Court of Session, the High Court, the UK Supreme Court and the European Court of Human Rights. Dorothy is currently counsel to the Investigatory Powers Tribunal in Scotland and chair of the Police Appeals Tribunal. She also spent 9 years, from 2002 to 2011, as an advocate deputy at the Crown Office. And during that time, she made history, becoming the first woman to be appointed as principal advocate deputy. She has conducted many complex prosecutions and appeals. These included the first prosecution of Peter Tobin and the prosecutions relating to the Operation Algebra investigation, which resulted in 8 men being convicted for offences relating to the sexual abuse of children. From the comments made since news of her nomination became known, it is very clear that Dorothy is also, and rightly, highly respected for her determination to speak up for the rights and the interests of the victims of crime. I believe Dorothy Bain will be a Lord Advocate of the very highest calibre. My nomination for Solicitor General for Scotland is Ruth Charteris QC. Ruth is also a lawyer who commands respect, rightly, across the legal profession. She has been an advocate for more than 20 years. For 8 of those years, she was a standing junior counsel for the Scottish Government, advising and representing the Government in a number of cases. For the past year, she has served as Advocate Deputy at the Crown Office. She also chairs the Fitness to Practice panel of the Scottish Social Services Council. Ruth will bring to the role of Solicitor General a valuable combination of public law and prosecution experience, and I am absolutely delighted to nominate her today. Presiding Officer, Dorothy Bain and Ruth Charteris are both individuals of the highest ability and integrity, and I believe that together they will make an outstanding and formidable team. It is, I think, worth noting that if these appointments are approved by Parliament today, this will mark the first occasion on which the roles of Lord Advocate and Solicitor General have both been held by women at the same time. That would represent a further welcome step towards more equal representation at the most senior levels in the legal profession and in public life more generally. However, while that may be, and I think it is, a welcome additional benefit of their appointments, it is not the reason for their appointments. Fundamentally, I am nominating Dorothy Bain and Ruth Charteris because they are both supremely well qualified for the roles they are being asked to do. They have a wealth of professional experience that I am sure will benefit the Scottish Government, the Crown Office and the justice system more generally in Scotland. So it is with great pleasure, Presiding Officer, therefore, that I move this motion, that the Parliament agrees that it be recommended to Her Majesty that Dorothy Bain QC be appointed as Lord Advocate and Ruth Charteris QC be appointed as Solicitor General for Scotland.
Thank you. I call Douglas Ross.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. At the outset, I want to echo what the First Minister has said and place on record my thanks to James Wolfe and Alison Dorolo for their service over a particularly challenging number of years. I'd also like to join the First Minister in offering my congratulations and those of my party to Dorothy Bain on her appointment as Lord Advocate and Ruth Charteris as she takes on the role of Solicitor General. For the first time, both of our top law officer positions in Scotland will be held by women, which not only makes history, but provides the next generation of young women with new role models to look up to. But there is also absolutely no doubt that these appointments have been made because they are two very incredibly qualified individuals with vast experience of Scotland's legal system. As the First Minister has outlined, Dorothy Bain has conducted some of the most high-profile criminal prosecutions and appeals, including that of Peter Tobin, ending in his conviction and a life sentence. Dorothy Bain is clearly held in extremely high regard by her colleagues in the legal profession, who have noted just how highly respected she is across the entire legal system. And some I've spoken to just in the last couple of days have commented on both the appointments as being extremely strong. Dorothy Bain comes to this new role at a time when the importance of the Lord Advocate seems to have taken on even more significance in Scotland over the last few years, and that is likely to continue. Before we get into the challenges facing the new Lord Advocate, let me put on record again that my party supports splitting up the role, as the First Minister mentioned in her own remarks. We have raised concerns about the dual role since devolution began, and those concerns have only become more acute as time has passed. There is a serious conflict between the head of the Crown Office and the Chief Legal Adviser to the Scottish Government. While I am confident that Dorothy Bain will handle this conflict with dedication and professionalism, the problems created by the dual role cannot be rectified by the skill and commitment of the person holding the office. The issue is systemic, it is inherent. By their nature, these dual roles at times conflict with each other. The Alex Salmond scandal exposed the weaknesses for all to see. Time and again, it seemed that the dual role had put people in impossible positions. They appeared destined to fail because there was no way to fulfil both roles properly. The role of the Lord Advocate was stretched to its limits and found wanting, to the detriment of the Scottish public and women at the heart of that affair. So separating the roles is essential to restore public confidence in the position, and while we appreciate these things cannot be rushed, there does appear to be consensus in this Parliament to reform, and we look forward to the Scottish Government bringing forward their consultation. So while we wish Dorothy Bain great success, I hope this is the last time this Parliament appoints a Lord Advocate under the current dual remit. The task facing both the new Lord Advocate and Solicitor General is enormous. In recent years, it is well known that the Crown Office and the Lord Advocate have become embroiled in a series of scandals. Catastrophic failings have been the focal point of press attention for a number of years, and they're not going to go away. Malicious prosecutions over the Rangers case will end up costing the taxpayer a fortune, although we still do not know how much. We need transparency over those costs first and foremost, but in time we need to know what went wrong and ensure it never happens again. My party has been vocal about the problems with fatal accident inquiries and the length of time they often take. We must see action here. There is also a far wider problem exacerbated by the COVID pandemic. The backlog of trials has put the justice system under severe strain, and the law officers will have our support as they seek to tackle that issue. On the horizon, there's also the looming shadow of a referendum bill, which this government seems determined to bring forward. I trust in the new Lord Advocate. We have someone with the experience to speak truth to power at this pivotal point in Scotland's history as we seek to ensure that we rebuild from the COVID pandemic and focus on that more than anything else. The challenges are numerous, and I applaud Dorothy Bain and Ruth Charteris for agreeing to take them on. My party will support them in their efforts to improve Scottish legal system as they seek to restore public confidence at this crucial moment in our history. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call on Anna Sarwar.
Presiding Officer, can I join Nicola Sturgeon and Douglas Ross in thanking James Wolfe and Alison Derulo for their dedicated service to our country, both highly respected in their professions, both working through really challenging times. Our entire country owes them a debt of gratitude. Part of the joy of devolution in this Parliament is the chance to reimagine how Scotland looks, sounds and feels. Historians may disagree on who exactly was the first Lord Advocate, but perhaps the strongest claim to that title is Sir Ross Grimley, who in 1483 served as a legal adviser to King James III. The Scotland that welcomed this new Parliament in 1999 would have been unrecognisable to Sir Ross in almost every way. But in the post of Lord Advocate, despite having changed purpose and character in those 516 years, we still, in a few respects, have been familiar to him. Most obviously, it was almost always held by, or always held by, a man. In fact, even with the green shoots of a new type of Scottish politics sprouting in 1999, it took another 8 years before the first woman would hold Scotland's highest legal office. When this process is over, it is likely that both Scotland's most senior legal offices will be held by women, not based on tokenism, but based on merit. An important moment to remark upon in a profession which, much like politics, still has a long way to go before it looks like the people it claims to serve. Looking at the careers of both Dorothy Bain QC and Ruth Charteris QC, it is clear to me that Scotland will have in post fierce defenders of human rights and the champions of victims' voices. Their colleagues speak of two individuals who are driven by empathy and a desire for justice. We all in this Parliament, and indeed this country, need and want them to succeed. There will, of course, be times when people in this place express dismay with slow and too often what may appear to be cruel and impersonal wheels of justice. We will call, like in the cases of Emma Caldwell or indeed of Millie Main and far too many others, for the new Lord Advocate to act with compassion and purpose to ensure that the law is not only followed, but that justice is done. Such interactions between the politicians and the courts are inevitable when what is at stake is often to the core of our sense of values and fairness in our country. None of that will be a reflection on the good characters, good values and good judgments of the two holders of that office. But it is clear that we do need to look at the reform of the role of the Lord Advocate, as has been said by both the First Minister and by Douglas Ross. In fact, while much of modern Scotland would be alien to Sir Ross, the closeness of the Chief Legal Officer charged with conducting Scotland's public prosecutions to the nation's political leadership might just be all too familiar. Since then, there has developed a legal principle that in matters of legal judgment, what matters is not just whether there was in fact bias, but whether there is the possible appearance of bias too. A more recent history has tipped that issue out of the seminar rooms of law schools and onto the front pages of our newspapers. That's why we need to have serious discussions in this Parliament about the separation of power between the person who's in charge of prosecutions in Scotland and the chief legal adviser to the government. We will proudly support Dorothy Bain and Ruth Charteris in taking on these vital roles in Scotland's public life, but we will also call on colleagues across this Parliament to make it contingent on us to reform the offices going forward. In doing so, we will all play a small part in changing the tone and tenor of Scotland's long history. We cannot lose sight of the injustices that still remain in our society and our country, and the work of building that more perfect nation is one that is a collective duty for us all.
Thank you. I now call on Maggie Chapman.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. On behalf of the Scottish Greens, I am pleased to support the nomination of both Dorothy Bain QC as Lord Advocate and Ruth Charteris QC as Solicitor General. Last week, I spoke in this chamber about how our justice system should exist to correct imbalances of power, how our justice system should not be used disproportionately by the rich and powerful against those who are marginalised, left behind, and powerless. These appointments, I hope, will allow us as a nation to shift the power imbalances that exist that are deeply embedded in our justice system. In the same way as this new Parliament better reflects the diversity of our country than ever before and promises to be a more progressive voice for Scotland, so I hope that these appointments today of two outstanding women will allow us to look afresh at our justice system and reform it for the better. Last week, I talked about the need to redress the power imbalance in our justice system and institutions that result in the woefully low rate of prosecution of men who rape and sexually assault women, and the lack of trauma-informed support available to traumatised survivors, of the fact that British and minority ethnic people are shamefully overrepresented in prisons and are subjected to a different standard, often by our police and court systems, and often disproportionately the victims of hate crime, that our prisons are being overwhelmingly used to incarcerate the poor while substantively failing to reduce reoffending. I am hopeful that the appointments today will allow us to act on these injustices. I know that Dorothy Bain QC has a strong track record of prosecuting sexual offences and has done considerable work, often pro bono, on cases which have pushed forward the rights of women complainers in sexual crime cases. I'm also aware of her determined work in support of victims of racially motivated violence, as exemplified by her support for the family of Sheku Bayo, who was, as I'm sure we all know, died after being pinned down by police in custody. The choice to then smear and criminalise him after his death compounds that initial injustice. And her compassion, empathy and desire for justice for the families of those who have completed suicide in custody are exactly the qualities we want in our Lord Advocate. We will, later on this afternoon, be discussing how we tackle Scotland's drugs death crisis. I very much look forward to engaging with our two new senior law officers on a care-based approach of support and treatment rather than one of criminalisation. I hope that we as a country can focus on what is genuinely in the public interest as regards the drugs death crisis. Gillian Mackay and I will elaborate on this later on today, but I hope that the new Lord Advocate will agree to roll out, as soon as possible, pre-arrest diversion schemes that do not result in a criminal record and therefore stop wrecking people's lives with those criminal records. We need a deep change in our approach to justice. We need to keep survivors of sexual and domestic violence safe. We need to recognise that Black Lives Matter. We need to approach substance misuse as a public health and social justice issue. I look forward, with hope, to working with our new senior law officers. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call on Willie Rennie.
Next month, it will mark 6 years since the tragic death of Lamara Bell and John Yule by the side of the M9 motorway. Presiding Officer, you'll recall the circumstances. Despite calls to the police, it was days before they responded. And despite numerous promises of a fatal accident inquiry, the family are still left without answers. The tragedy of their deaths has been compounded by the snail's pace of the Crown Office. This is no way to treat anyone. And they are not alone. There is a long list of delays. Warm words are wholly inadequate. Reform is long overdue, and that must be led by the new Lord Advocate. Scotland has the worst drug death rate in Europe, the developed world, and in fact in the UK as well. In the UK, it's four times the rate in Scotland here compared with the rest of the country. In March, this Parliament backed our motion to divert people gripped by drugs into treatment and cease prosecution and imprisonment. We need a new approach from the Crown Office, another huge responsibility for the Lord Advocate. I wish to thank the outgoing Lord Advocate and Solicitor General for their personal service and commitment to the country. It has been quite remarkable. It is worth remembering that the problems faced by the Crown Office on fatal accident inquiries, on drugs, as well as other long-standing issues, reach back well before the current incumbent was in post. And the Lord Advocate is appointed and acts within the policy framework of this government. So the Scottish Government cannot shrug their shoulders. They too bear a heavy responsibility for the lack of reform in the Crown Office. There is one specific reform for the First Minister. The role needs to be split to end the apparent conflicts of interest. It is no longer appropriate for the Lord Advocate to act as both a prosecutor and the politician sitting round the Cabinet table. This is not new. But in the latter days of the last Parliament, the conflict of interest between those duties fell into sharp focus. Even the impression of a conflict undermines the integrity of the role. Separate positions with an independent director of prosecutions to run the Crown Office and the Procurator Fiscal Service could bring both focus to the task of recovery and justice, as well as a healthy separation of powers. Finally, I've been a supporter of confirmation hearings for top roles in our public bodies. The confirmation hearings would enable MSPs to question and debate the challenging issues, many of which I've already mentioned, for the new post holder, as well as their suitability for the position. I think we should have had such hearings for the Lord Advocate and the Solicitor General today, rather than the rush process that we are engaged in this afternoon. It may even have been helpful for the nominees today to face such a hearing. But that is not open to us today. We are fortunate, very fortunate, to have such respected and talented nominees in Dorothy Bain and Ruth Charteris. They are widely respected in the legal profession and beyond. So I wish to thank them for their contribution so far. I wish them well today, and I look forward to working with them in partnership as we proceed over the next few years. Thank you.
Thank you. I will now put the question to the Chamber. The question is that motion 406 in the name of Nicola Sturgeon on appointment of law officers be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed. Before we go on to the next item of business, I will remind members that social distancing measures are in place in the Chamber and across the Holyrood campus, and I ask that members take care to observe these measures, including when entering and exiting the Chamber. And please only use the aisles and walkways to access your seat and when moving around the Chamber. The next item of business is a debate on motion 400 in the name of Angela Constance on tackling drug-related deaths. I will give a couple of minutes till members rearrange their seating positions.